Hello everyone! This video is all about the cost efficiency of the militia line in post-imperial age. I don't say it's all about champions because some civilizations, even some of those with bonuses for the militia line, don't have access to champions but only to two-handed swordsmen. I would say the most common function for the militia line is fighting or countering so-called trash units. The term trash unit refers to units that don't cost any gold. Let's list these units in their post-imperial version. The Scout Cavalry line, so the Hussar, the Skirmisher line, so the Elite Skirmisher, or for the Vietnamese and their allies, the Imperial Skirmisher, and the Spearman line, so the Halberdier. But there are also some other units in AoE2 that only certain civilizations have access to and that don't cost any gold as well, and hence can be called trash units too. The Magyar Hussar line of the Magyar, so the Elite Magyar Hussar, the Geniteur line of the Berbers, so the Elite Geniteur, the Archer line of the Persians, so the Crossbowmen, since the Persians don't have access to arbalists, and of course the Militia line of the Malay, so the two-handed swordsmen, since the Malay don't have access to champions. The second most common function of the Militia line probably is fighting or countering the Eagle Scout line, so elite Eagle Warriors in post-imperial. Certainly the Militia line can be used in situations other than fighting trash units or Eagle Warriors as well. For example, units of the militia line have a reputation of trading cost efficiently versus the camel line, small groups of unguarded siege units, some unique infantry units like condottieri or huscarls, and buildings obviously, although they also receive a lot of damage in return due to their relatively low hit points and pierce armor. But for this video, let's stick to three applications of the militia line: fighting trash units, the Eagle Scout line, and other members of the militia line. Since the different civilizations have very different militia lines due to bonuses or missing technologies, we will cover 15 different militia lines. The Chinese champions, as an example for champions missing only the supplies upgrade. The Byzantines champions, as an example for champions missing only the last attack upgrade, Blast Furnace. The Berbers champions, as an example for fully upgraded generic champions. The Aztecs champions, which are fully upgraded and have an extra +4 attack. The Bulgarians two-handed swordsmen, which are fully upgraded and have an extra +5 armor. The Burmese champions, which are fully upgraded and have an extra +3 attack. The Celts champions, which are missing only the Squires upgrade, but end up being approximately 5% faster due to their civilization bonus. The Goths champions, which are missing the supplies upgrade and the last armor upgrade, plate mail armor, but cost 35% less. The Japanese champions, which are fully upgraded and attack 33% faster. The Malay two-handed swordsmen, which are fully upgraded and cost 65 food instead of 45 food and 20 gold. The Malian champions, which are missing only the last attack upgrade, Blast Furnace, but have an extra +3 pierce armor. The Portuguese champions, which are missing only squires, but cost 15% less gold. The Slavs champions, which are fully upgraded and deal 5 cleave damage, which can't be reduced by armor, to nearby enemies. The Teutons champions, which are fully upgraded and have an extra +2 armor. And the Vikings champions, which are fully upgraded, have +20% hit points, 5 bonus damage against cavalry units and 4 bonus damage against camel units. I'm simulating all matchups and creating all cost efficiency matrices with my combat simulator, which you can find here. You can also find a video about the simulator on my channel. Before heading into the simulation results and matrices, I'd like to remind you of the settings. We are in post-imperial age, so here we are not talking about the costs to fully upgrade the units. Our assumption is that they are already fully upgraded. The results are always about cost efficiency, not about population efficiency, so not about something like 1v1 or 100v100 fights. We will have a look at both cost efficiency with equal resource worth and cost efficiency with late game market exchange rates. Alright, first we assume all resources to be of equal worth and let each of the 15 post-imperial militia lines fight versus each other. Each matchup is simulated 40 times, which makes 15 squared times 40 combat simulations, so 9000 overall. Still, there will be a small amount of randomness in the results, since some aspects of AoE2 itself, such as a unit's target selection, are random to a certain degree. Now let's look at the results. Let's start at the bottom of the list. When looking at the Chinese, we can immediately observe the importance of the supplies upgrade. The Chinese have access to all upgrades for champions except for the supplies upgrade, and they perform very poorly compared to all other militia lines, even those without Blast Furnace, like the Byzantines or the Malians militia lines. When comparing Chinese champions with champions of the Berbers, which are fully upgraded including the supply stack, Lanchester's Law, which you might know from Spirit of the Laws videos, predicts a cost efficiency ratio of 0.4175 from the Chinese point of view. This is almost exactly what my combat simulator calculated. The Malay two-handed swordsmen also perform poorly because their unique tag, Forced Levy, doesn't change their total cost, and in the current scenario we assume all resources to be of equal worth. Hence, they are just usual two-handed swordsmen for the same price most civs get champions. The militia lines of the Malians and Byzantines are below average because they lack the blast furnace upgrade. The militia line of the Berbers, as mentioned before, serves as a reference to generic fully upgraded champions. The militia lines of the Portuguese and Celts perform slightly above generic post-imperial champions, thanks to their slight cost reduction or speed bonus respectively. Now we enter the top tier militia lines regarding their melee combat performance. The Teutons and Vikings militia lines are already far above average, with their armor or hit point bonus respectively. The next civ might come as a big surprise to many. The Goths champions are not in the top 5 anymore. They surely would have taken first or second place if it wasn't for the relatively new supplies tech. We've already seen that this tech has a huge influence on the champion's cost efficiency, and since the Goths are one of the few civilizations that don't have access to it, their champions suffer severely against other strong militia lines. The places 5, 4 and 3 go to the militia lines of the Burmese, the Bulgarians and the Aztecs with their attack or armor bonuses, respectively. Second place goes to the Japanese with their attack speed bonus, and first place regarding cost efficiency goes to the Slavs with their armor penetrating cleave damage. At this point I want to show you two observations we will repeatedly see in this video. The first one is, small difference between the stats of two units sometimes have a huge impact on their cost efficiencies and sometimes no impact at all. For example, champions of the Goths are very cost efficient against Burmese champions, but cost inefficient against champions of the Aztecs, although the latter ones only deal 1 damage more than the Burmese champions. The reason for that is that Aztecs champions kill champions of the Goths with 4 hits, while 4 hits of Burmese champions leaves champions of the Goths with 2 hit points remaining. The seemingly small attack damage discrepancy leads to a huge difference in the resulting cost efficiencies. The second observation shouldn't be a surprise, but I'd like to point it out anyway. Armor bonuses work especially well against units with a lower attack and are not very impressive against enemies with a high attack. An extreme example would be the Huskarl. Most AO2 players would say that Huskarls have pretty impressive pierce armor. However, a trebuchet projectile won't be very impressed by the Huskarl's pierce armor. It will just kill the Huskarl with a single hit anyway. We can observe this effect in our matrix as well. The Bulgarian two-handed swordsmen decisively lose to champions of the Aztecs or Burmese, but trade much more cost efficiently than the latter ones when fighting champions of the Byzantines, Malians, or two-handed swordsmen of the Malay, all of which only have 15 or 16 attack after upgrades. Alright, now we let the militia lines fight each other again, but this time with the late game market exchange rates. So in a scenario in which you have to acquire your gold by selling food or wood at the market. Now the matrix looks like that. Okay, I think I can spot an anomaly here, but let's first note that the order of the list is pretty much the same as before, with two exceptions. The most obvious one is that the Malay militia line seizes first place far ahead of the previous leader, the Slavs. With the late game market exchange rates, Malay two-handed swordsmen only cost 11 gold, while most other militia lines cost 27.7 gold. Hence, in most late game situations, the Malay two-handed swordsmen can outnumber militia line units of other civilizations by more than 2-1. The second exception is that the Goths reclaim a place in the top 3. The reason for that is that the supply stack only reduces the food cost of the militia line, while the civ bonus of the Goths reduces both food and gold costs by 35%. In case you're interested, here is an audit version of the same matrix. Now let's have a look at the cost efficiency of our militia lines against trash units. First, we again start with assuming resources to be of equal worth and let them fight Hussars and Magyar Hussars. Here is the matrix. I think it's not very surprising that the militia lines fight cost efficiently against Hussars, especially the Bulgarian two-handed swordsmen and the Teutons champions with their higher armor can shine here, and the champions of the Vikings, with their attack bonus against cavalry and their higher hit points, are also doing a great job in defeating Hussars. Against elite Magyar Hussars, things are looking much worse. Fully upgraded post-imperial champions don't trade cost efficiently versus elite Magyar Hussars. Only militia lines with strong bonuses can trade cost efficiently when fighting them. Viking champions are doing the best job here. When assuming late game market exchange rates, things are getting really awful. There is only one militia line that can keep up with Hussars in trash wars, the Malay one, because it doesn't cost any gold either. Against elite Magyar Hussars, there is not a single militia line that can compete with them in trash wars, and it's not even close. Next, let's have a look at the cost efficiency of our militia lines against halberdiers. Again, first assuming all resources to be of equal worth. As we can see, all militia lines are highly cost efficient against halberdiers. Again, at the top we can find the Bulgarians and the Teutons with their armor bonuses, which are extremely effective against low damage units, such as halberdiers. The Slavs take the third place thanks to their cleave damage. When assuming late game market exchange rates, there are four militia lines that trade cost efficiently against halberdiers. The two-handed swordsmen of the Malay, primarily because they only cost food, the militia lines of the Bulgarians and the Teutons because of their high armor, and the Slavs champions because of their cleave damage. So this matrix tells us that when playing as Slavs, Teutons or Bulgarians, selling food or wood for gold in order to create champions or two-handed swordsmen in case of the Bulgarians is a cost-efficient way of dealing with halberdiers, even when 100 food or 100 wood is only worth 17 gold at the market. Next, let's have a look at the cost efficiency of militia lines against ranged trash units. Again, first assuming all resources to be of equal worth. I've set the hit and run behavior of the ranged units to medium hit and run. If you want more information about the hit and run settings, have a look at the simulator's info page or my YouTube video about the simulator. Both are linked in this video's description. Looking at the matrix, first of all, no surprise, we see that all militia lines are very effective against elite and imperial skirmishes. We'll talk about the other two units in a minute. It shouldn't come as a surprise that now the first place goes to the Malians with their additional pierce armor of 3 for all infantry. Due to the low attack damage of all ranged trash units, their additional pierce armor reduces the damage of all incoming arrows or spears to 1. The Vikings get second place thanks to their increased hit points. And the third place goes to the Aztecs with their higher damage output, mainly because their champions kill elite skirmishers and Persian crossbowmen with 2 hits instead of 3, like all other militia lines. The Japanese with their higher attack rate and the Celts with their higher movement rate share fourth place. Some other militia lines fall behind for different reasons. The Portuguese because of their lack of squires, the Malay and Bulgarians because they only have two-handed swordsmen, which have less hit points, and the Chinese because they lack the supplies upgrade. It might come as a surprise for some of you, but the Goths perform the worst, by far. The lack of the last armor upgrade is such a huge drawback that they can't compensate that with their higher numbers. This again illustrates the importance of armor or pierce armor respectively, especially against enemies with low attack damage, such as ranged trash units. Of course, even in this scenario, there are much worse militia lines in AoE 2, like the one of the Tatars, which lack the second and the last armor upgrade, the supply stack and the champions upgrade. But of the militia lines shown here, the one of the Goths perform the worst in this given scenario. Regarding the elite geniturs and the Persian crossbowmen, both of them don't have an easy time against the militia lines, but with very good micromanagement or buffer units in front of them, they could reach cost efficiency. But remember that this matrix does already include a decent amount of micromanagement, so if you don't hit and run at all, ranged trash units will perform even worse than depicted here. When assuming late game market exchange rates, things start to look bleak again for most militia lines. Only two militia lines can be used cost efficiently against all ranged trash units when you need to get the gold by selling food and wood at the market. The Malay two-handed swordsmen and the Malian champions. The first one because they don't cost gold, the latter one because of their awesome pierce armor. If your opponent happens to only have access to elite skirmishers because he has picked any civilization except Persians, Berbers and Vietnamese, you could also cost efficiently use the militia lines of the Vikings, Aztecs, Japanese and Celts against elite skirmishers, but all other militia lines won't trade cost efficiently if you have to acquire your gold at the market. and you will hear it one more time, the Goths perform the worst in this scenario as well. Lastly, let's have a look at the cost efficiency of our militia lines against units of the Eagle Scout line. So in post-imperial age, the elite Eagle Warriors of the Aztecs, Incas and Mayans. There is not much to say this time. All militia lines perform extremely well. The Bulgarians perform the best, thanks to their high armor, and the Chinese perform the worst due to their lack of the supply stack. But even they are still very cost efficient. When assuming late game market exchange rates, all militia lines just completely dominate all three Eagle lines due to the Eagle's high gold costs. Alright, so what's eventually the conclusion of this video? The supply stack is very important. It's rarely advisable to use the militia line if your civ doesn't have access to this tech. The Goths certainly have lost the top spot due to the introduction of the supply stack. In all simulated matchups, one or several other infantry civs can now catch up on them or even outperform them. However, I'm not saying that the Goths are underpowered now. I think their new bonus, Free Loom, is extremely strong and still underestimated by many players. The militia line of the Malay is underwhelming before players run out of gold or when trading is an option, but very strong in trash wars where they trade very well against elite skirmishers and halberdiers and decently against hussars. And who has the best post-imperial militia line after all? Of course, as we've seen, the answer heavily depends on the given scenario. I think it's safe to say that in trash wars with late game market exchange rates, the Malay militia line is the best. When assuming resources to be of equal worth, so before gold runs out on the map, if I was forced to make a choice, I would pick the Slavs, followed by the Bulgarians. And one last thing I want to add, I'm pretty sure that the militia line is not used as often as it should be on most skill levels, as they are cost efficient against a variety of unique units as well, especially since the introduction of supplies. However, this will be part of another video. Thanks for watching and have an excellent rest of your day.